morning. A policeman friend of mine showed me something very unusual last week. He trained a sporting dog, a spaniel, bred for generations to win field trials, not to retrieve shot pheasants, but to sniff out explosives. Now, we nearly always see Alsatians or retrievers being taken by the police or the army to frisk a building before important people enter. But this copper claimed this spaniel so enthusiastic that he'll keep on working for longer than any other breed, simply because he enjoys it so much. And he's small enough to pop through trap doors in ceilings, or into the holds of ships, or central heating ducts. But what puzzled me was how they persuaded him to show the slightest interest in the smell of explosives, which I'd have thought was about the last thing a dog would find exciting. Now, the way they train them for explosives is by cashing in on their natural instinct to hunt by scent, and to retrieve their quarry to their master's hand. Oh, it's all a game in the spaniel's eyes. He learns to play with a canvas dummy which the boss throws like a ball for the dog to retrieve. And then he throws it into cover where the dog can't see it, and has to search it out by scent. And surprise, surprise, it smells of explosives, because a newly fired cartridge case had been placed in the dummy. And after all, the dog associates the smell of explosives with a game of find and bring, and he thinks it's a signal for a game with the boss. But last Sunday lunchtime, Clarrie Grundy was finding that there was no fun in life at all. Because as if things weren't bad enough at Grange Farm, Joe was wanting her to grind flour as well.
Pretty simple enough to do.
Right, then you do it.
In most buds.
In the saucepan on the cooker.
All we've got to do is get hold of one of them old flour mills.
That's the older
than. You're nearer the cooker than I am.
Grind up the wheat and stick it in a little brown bag.
Well, that odd morning. It's my turn to milk again.
And it was my turn to cook the dinner and look after the children. Like it always is.
You could grab a handful of them free paper bags every time you go to the supermarket.
I was only asking you to pass the spuds.
Once in a blue moon, they're both asleep, so I can sit down to my dinner in peace.
Have to turn them inside out, I suppose. Or we could have our own writing on the bag. Green farm, home grown.
Did you ask them to set Jeff or Dave Williams?
Mm. We could not.
I might have a go with that.
I'm craving that for his Christmas stocking.
You could sell the stuff in one of them dark elf fruit shops and we'd be raking it in. We'd run in the eye for Tony Artis.
There's no more gravy.
No, there ain't. If you're planning to use wheat that's been rotting in the cart shed since the merchant turned it down, I don't think that's going to be very healthy.
Nothing wrong with that wheat. Just fussy.
Can I have the butter then?
Got that many wild oats and bits in it, you'd do better to sell it like it is and call it muesli, like he said.
You reckon we could?
The butter, Clarrie.
You know where the fridge is? Of course we couldn't, Joe. Don't be daft.
Oh, Lemmy, I don't know what's got into you today.
Well, who are you?
It was up half the night with the baby. The minute I got into bed and closed my eyes, William jumped on me and wanted to play tigers. I cooked the breakfast, washed the baby's things, washed the breakfast things, read to William, tongue to Edward, listened to you two going on and on and on while I was cooking a dinner, and now I can't even eat in peace.
I'd have read to William, you should have said.
Clarrie, where's this? Clarrie, where's that? Mommy, mommy, mama! I never have a minute to myself, and now you're expecting me to grind flour as well.
It's all right, I found the butter.
It can't be that difficult if that artist's going to do it.
Pat Archer has got her men trained. Even Tommy will give her a hand with the washing up.
You want my lad drawing up fishy?
Yeah, you funny little chap. Always clinging onto that door.
There's numbers. That's what I am. You're grinding me down in my wheat. And you're all in it together.
Is that Edward? Shall I say so?
Ah, that's William. Once his granddad is fit.
Oh, go. You two can't even tell him apart.
Perhaps we should offer to do the washing up. Do you think she meant it? About the flaring?
Not she'll come rain. I wonder if there's anything for after.
I know I've seen it somewhere.
We could always buy one, Dad.
Why waste good money on a flaring when I know we got one? Here, give
us that with it. Is it worth it?
Yeah.
You could be sitting down reading the Sunday papers instead of opening rubbish or rain.
This ain't rubbish. Perfect working order. I bet you don't even know what it is.
Cool side, sir. It's a mango.
Bit of polish. Be as good as new. I mean, useful if the washing machine broke, is.
Yeah, well, I wouldn't offer it to Clarrie, the mood she's in. You might stick your egg in it and try and squeeze some sense into your brains.
Very nice fit of all the hours your mother spent turning that handle. Took all day. Washing then, you know. None of this. Fling it in the machine and sit and read a book.
The master told me. Didn't get a decent Monday dinner for years. cold meat and pickle, and it always tasted of soap.
Alf got his fingers trapped in it once, it's half varmint.
Mum would have the radio on. That dance band bloke, what was his name? Victor Sylvester.
Yeah, that's him.
Playing requests for people in funny sounding places. Zarawak, Bulawayo.
Yeah, well, we had an empire then. Ain't even got two-way family favourites now, and I used to like him, Mr.
I think Bulawayo's where Nigel Blodger is going.
Mind you. It was always the way in the old days.
He's got an uncle out there.
That's what I mean. And Africa wasn't far enough for Frank Archer. Oh, no. They had to ship him off to New Zealand to get him out the way.
Look, are we moving this mangle or what?
The trouble he's got. The stories I could tell you about what he used to get up.
Oh, I've heard them, Dad. Are we looking for this flour mill?
I ain't sure it's in here now, something.
Oh.
I might have seen it in the other outhouse.
Oh, you go and look then. Oh, a cup of tea. Freezing.
Yeah, I could do it by myself. All this damp and rust is getting in my lungs. You reckon Clarrie will have one on the go?
Oh, I shouldn't think so. But you might take the kids for a walk. But if the worst comes to the worst, you know where the kettle is, don't you?
I hope you don't mind us popping in like this.
Of course not. Like a cup of tea? That'd be lovely. Only Elizabeth got her book list from the test.
Yeah, I wonder if you might be able to lend me some of the books.
Of course, if I've got them. Jennifer's the one to try, really. Got more books in her studio than books at the library.
We thought of that, but they're out for the day.
Elizabeth! It's nice to see you anyway.
It's all right, dear.
We should be back this evening, do you know. I wanted a word with her myself.
They're taking Debbie out to lunch.
Everyone's out today. Sheila and David as the young farmers do.
And Tony's taken our lot off to a birthday party.
Perhaps it's Jennifer's birthday.
No, but it is Peggy's on Tuesday.
Yeah, it is. I must get a car tomorrow.
Is she having a party?
I thought I might give her one.
Surprise.
How old is she?
60, isn't it?
Well, she's been a bit upset lately about us going into organic farming and things. Hopes it might smooth things over.
And she'd enjoy a party at her age.
Elizabeth, there's no need to talk about her as though she's got one foot in the grave.
Yes, I should think she would. All her family around her.
Oh, it's not my idea of a party.
Well, we know what your idea of a party is, and I don't think Peggy would enjoy that very much. It's a kind thought, Pat.
Well, Peggy and I are always going to have our differences, but she's Tony's mother and family's family.
You can say that again.
Why don't you show Pat your book list?
Oh, yes, let's have a look. It's awfully long. They expect you to do a lot of background reading.
I'm pleased to hear it. I want you to take these A-levels seriously.
Oh, yeah, there's a couple of books on your biology list that I needed for my women's studies. I can let you have those.
Great.
Are you sure you don't need them?
Not at the moment. I'm giving women's studies a rest for a bit.
Oh?
Oh, only for the rest of this term. I'll start again in January.
There's a new tutor coming then, isn't there?
Right, well, you are up on all the gossip, aren't you?
Yes, but that isn't the reason.
I'm just so busy with Tony getting this organic farming underway.
Hello! Pat!
Oh, hello, Clarrie.
Can I
come in? Yes, of course. Hello, Clarrie.
Oh!
Come and sit down. You look exhausted. Isn't he awake in that sling?
Is that Edward? Can I have a peek? Sorry, I didn't realise you got me.
Don't be silly. Have a cup of tea. You look as though you could do with one.
Oh. Don't wake him, Elizabeth.
Isn't he sweet? All snuggled up against you like that.
Oh, they all look sweet when I'm asleep. William looks like an angel now, and the trouble I've had getting him here.
Not come all this way with the pushchair as well.
No wonder you look tired.
We can give you a lift back, can't we, Mum?
Yes.
I felt like a walk. Calm me down. We've been that ratty with Joe and Eddie.
You just had to get away from them. I know the feeling.
You could have left the children, surely.
If you ever need a babysitter...
No, I really wasn't very nice to him. That's why I come over. Babysitter to take up organic farming, see? Like you. And I really ought to do my bit.
Oh, well, we're still at the planning stage.
It's, fairly complicated, you know, Clarrie.
Yeah, oh, I know that. We thought we'd start in a small way, grinding our own wheat, see? So, I was wondering, if you haven't started yet, Pat, could I borrow your flour mill?
Why, Clarrie, I haven't got one. I'll tell you what I will give you.
Oh, yeah?
Something I promised you ages ago. My double buggy.
Right, William, stick the little soldier in
your
head. You all right with the baby,
Joe? Of course I am. You just wanted a little kettle, didn't you, eh? For old granddad.
I'll make some fresh tea when Eddie comes in.
No rush, Clarrie. You can make it yourself.
You can stop being nice to me. It's making me nervous. You throw me a flour mill, I'll grind the flour, I said.
Mm-hmm. It's a pity Tatarty didn't have one.
You can buy them, you know, in health food places.
At fancy prices.
Tat said we might try a junk shop.
Yeah. Nelson Gabriel might have one, I suppose.
He don't sell junk, he sells antiques.
Well, not anymore, he don't. Not now he's got his grand piano and his posh singer. He might be wanting to get rid of his stock cheap.
Worth a try, I suppose. Oh, William, not in your hair.
I bet Pat Archer's got one, really. She just ain't telling you.
Don't you be nasty about Pat. She was very nice to me, giving me her buggy and everything.
What's all that for?
It takes you longer and longer.
Any chance of a couple of drinks?
You know where the kettle is. Clarrie's busy with William and I got the bath.
All right. Met Harry Booker in the yard. There's a letter for you.
Bring it over then. In a bureau, is it?
Some house boy, the look of it. That face slow. Never did learn joined up writing.
Yeah. Lost the postmark, too. What's he after, I wonder?
His birthday tomorrow, isn't it? Oh,
rat,
unless you get him a card.
Well, he's after money, I expect, knowing our health.
Yeah, you're probably right. Yeah, he says he'd be passing here tomorrow, taking some scrap to Birmingham. He might drop in.
You might have a look through it, Dad. You might find a flour mill.
Well, that's nice. We could have a little party for him.
A party?
For a house? You don't want to waste the time on him, Clarrie. If he's staying into one of us with his presence, he's out of something. He might my word.
He might just want to see little Edward. He is their only uncle.
Well, want to see a baby? He must be joking.
He's their uncle. A wicked uncle. Isn't he, Edward?
We're not surprised he don't come more often the way you two carry on. If we gave him a little party, it would show him he's welcome.
He'd think it was a soft touch.
And he'd be on our backs for the rest of our life. That is right, Clarrie.
Pat's giving Peggy Archer a surprise party, and they don't get on too well. Family is family, after all.
They change her tune.
True enough, Clarrie. But there are some members of the family that you're better off trying to forget about. And in our family, it's out.
It was a lovely meal, Peg. Glad you enjoyed it. I can never get my pastry as light as yours.
Rubbish. Best homemade steak and kidney pie I've had in a long time. Oh. You'll have to watch it, though. You'll be getting fat.
You think so? I've been worried I was getting a bit scraggy.
All these slap-up meals. You've got something planned for tomorrow, of course.
Doesn't look like it.
But it's your birthday.
Oh, it's a bit silly making a fuss about birthdays at my age. Jack wants me to pop out for a drink, and I don't know if I'll bother.
Hasn't Jennifer invited you round? Or Pat and Tony?
No. I got a card from Lillian this morning, though. She never could remember dates.
Well, I think that's dreadful. We'll soon see about that.
Oh, no, Mum, please don't say anything.
Your own mother.
I'm used to it. And count on the fingers of one hand the times that my Jack remembered.
Oh, well, he was hard put to tell you what day of the week it was after time.
The children always did, though. Jennifer used to write little plays for them to act, and Lillian would make me a cake. Tony would pick some flowers from the garden. Oh, well.
Oh, Peg, don't fret. Perhaps they're planning a surprise for you.
I really don't mind if they've forgotten, but I hope they're not deliberately ignoring it.
Whatever would they want to do such a thing?
Not Jennifer, of course. I had quite a row with Pat last week about this organic farming nonsense. And it's none of my business, really. I was just being an interfering mother-in-law.
Well, you've only got Tony's best interests at heart.
He's a grown man and I'm an old woman. I shall have to learn to retire gracefully.
If you're old, what does that make me?
I'm 60, Mum. You can't call that middle-aged anymore.
You need a night out to cheer yourself up. There's this new singer Nelson's got. Mr. Gabriel reckons she's quite something.
Don't tell me you actually approve of something Nelson's done.
Oh, it'll come to no good, like all his harebrained schemes. But this girl sounds quite a nice class of person. She does proper songs. The old ones. None of this modern caterwauling. Get Jack Woolley to take you there.
Maybe. Although I don't know that an evening of 30s nostalgia is quite what I need at the moment.
Bye-bye then, you love. Remember, any time you pass in, you're very welcome.
Oh, Dad, do stop shrieking down the path and let Hebe get back.
Oh, Nelson.
Oh, Dad.
You've done it at last.
Have I? What?
I never thought I'd live to see the day.
Which day is this?
The day you brought a really nice girl home to see your old dad.
Mm, she is nice, isn't she?
Oh, a real old-fashioned beauty. Hey, I didn't think we bred women like that anymore.
A survival from a more gracious age, that's Hebe.
And so polite. A real lady.
Yes. Well, while we're on the subject of manners, Dad, I think yours could do with a little polishing.
Mine? What do you mean? I've got my teeth in, ain't I?
Yes, unfortunately. If you hadn't, we might perhaps have had a little less of the adventures of Nelson Gabriel Wonder Boy.
Oh, she was very interested in my stories. She's taken a real shine to you. Anybody can see that.
And as you pointed out, she has very good manners. She was too polite, actually, to fall asleep, but I saw her eyelids flicker more than once.
Well, you've had a very interesting life.
And you spared no one the lurid details. Did you have to bring up the mail van robbery?
No, well, they never proved nothing, and I said that.
Yes, Dad, I know you did. Do me a favor, will you?
Of course, son.
Don't say it again.
Oh.
If I have to turn to a life of crime to pay off my creditors...
Did you want the Rose Bowl money back? And I've got a bit put by.
It's all right. I just have a slight cash flow problem at all.
Well, that's what you said to the men from the electric, and they didn't look too impressed.
Yes, well, I'm holding them at bay. I am a little worried about the grand piano. Still, if the worst comes to the worst, Hebe could always sing unaccompanied. Her voice will stand it.
Oh, she has a lovely voice. Mm. Oh, you should have her on every night.
I couldn't afford to pay her. I can't afford to pay her for what she's doing now. Besides, I can think of more interesting ways for her to pass her evening.
Oh, Nelson, you bad lad.
There is a thin line, Dad, between being an eccentric old buffer full of roguish charm and a dirty old man. Tonight you came perilously close to crossing it.
I never laid a finger on her. I wouldn't dream of it.
The terms in which you describe your wish for me to give you grandchildren were positively agricultural.
Well, I only want to see you settle down with a nice girl. And she is a nice girl.
Yes, and I don't want her frightened off. Oh, well. Perhaps I can repair the damage with a quiet dinner hors d'oeuvre in my flat tomorrow.
Can I come?
No, you can't. But I expect I can get Nigel to mind the bar again. Perhaps I should go and check now.
I thought we were going to have a quiet evening together watching the telly.
Sorry, Dad. I daren't leave Podger alone too much. He tries to sell the customers brooms and scrubbing brushes along with their cocktails. And if I'm going to spend tomorrow evening with Hebe...
Oh, it would have been nice if she could have stayed, too. She had a bit of supper with us. A nice, cozy evening.
She had things to do in Borchester, and so have I. I tell you what, I've got one of her tapes in the car. You can put it on your little cassette, and she could sing you to sleep. That should give you pleasant dreams.
Well, that's all the food. Now what else have we got to get? Oh, just put these bags down and look at the lift. Oh, balloons. Mommy said we must have balloons. Oh, how sweet. We could get crackers, too, and streamers. Kate can decorate the living room. Nigel even let us hold the party at Home Farm. You've done all the organising. The surprise is the great thing. Oh, I do hope Granny Perkins doesn't let the cat out of the bag. Oh, look, there's Joe Grundy.
Yeah. His usual cheerful self, I see.
Hello, Joe.
Morning.
How's Clarrie, the baby?
Oh, working out. Some disaster, you know. Work. What a lot of bags.
Special occasion. Peggy's birthday. Having a little party for her.
Oh, Del's birthday, too. Clarrie's up and having a party for him. That's why I brought her in Portugal. Oh, what she buys won't stop the traffic.
Oh, I suppose we are a bit of an obstruction. Can we take this lot back to the car before we carry on? Yeah. Oh, well, hope Clarrie's party is a success, Joe.
I don't. The less they see her out, the better.
Oh, Joe, what a thing to say about your own son.
Yeah. Well, I ain't feeling in a very generous mood. Must be Cathy, name is it?
Are you talking to me, Joe?
Well, if the cap fits. Folks in a thin line of business might be neighbourly, give other folks helping hand.
Yes, sir, that's very true. Is this organic farming you're talking about now? Because if it is, then I've got some books I can lend you.
That ain't books they need, so is it? Flour mill.
Oh, flour mill, the sorts you turn by hand, you mean? Oh, Clarrie, Joe, I haven't got one.
So you said?
Oh, I had one once. I don't think I... Sorry, Jennifer, was that your foot?
You were saying...
It's a collection of crushed bones now.
You just have to buy one, won't you? Good hunting.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you. It's not done.
I think you've had a nice time. Why didn't you want Joe to have my flower? No, I didn't. Trouble old cat. Don't you see the idea from me and Tony? Expects us to provide the equipment and won't believe me when I say I haven't got it. I didn't buy one if he's so keen. Probably be better all round if he doesn't. I wouldn't buy flower Joe Grundy's grand. Heaven knows what you might find in it. That's another thing. It won't be Joe that'll do the grinding. It'll be another household chore for poor Clarrie, as usual. That woman leaves the love of a 19th century Russian serf. Oh, come, come. I'm sure Lillian doesn't have Andrew Sinclair chasing across Hades' berry with packs of borzoi, doesn't she? Well, perhaps I am exaggerating, but not much. I'd better get moving, otherwise I shall have Granny P on my tail. I promise to pick her up later on.
Yeah, the wicked wolves won't blow that door down in a hurry.
You don't want to go up in crates about like that at your age. You do yourself a mischief.
So, how did you get in?
As you say, no one will be able to use that door now you've got all those crates stacked against it.
No, they won't, will they? I must put a better bolt on that side door.
Demi, you barricading yourself in for a seat?
Precautionary measures. An Englishman's home is no longer his castle, alas. So many people have the right of entry. And they can cut off so much.
Oh, after their money, are they? That'd explain it.
Explain what?
Why, there's a man with a briefcase sitting on your front doorstep. That's why he's come round the side.
Oh, is there? What does he look like?
Well, he ain't a bailiff, not tough enough. And he ain't wearing overalls, so I don't suppose he's come to cut anything off.
No, that's something. Oh, perhaps it's only the tax man.
Only? My word, he must be in trouble.
Contrary to popular myth, I've always found the Department of Inland Revenue comparatively civilized. At least they seem to have grasped the basic premise that they won't get their money unless they let you go on working.
As bad as that, is it?
One must speculate to accumulate. My ship will come in. But I'm sure you didn't come round here to discuss my financial problems.
Nope. I might be able to help. Because you might have some that I want, and I might be prepared to pay for it.
Really? I can't imagine what.
A flour mill.
I was right. I couldn't imagine. Why ever should you think I would have a flour mill?
The old-fashioned sort you term is an handle. You sell antiques, don't you?
No, not anymore. And not those sort of antiques than I did. You can buy new ones at the health food shop.
I know, I look. A fancy price.
It seems the only option open to you. Otherwise, you were reduced to panic where the grain was too thin.
No, I don't think so. I reckon I know where I can lay my hands on one if I ask you.
I feel quite nervous. I think it's silly.
She should be here soon. I told her what time to pick me up.
I hope so. I don't know that the children will keep quiet much longer. They're overexcited as it is. She's not likely to drop in at Bridge Farm first, is she, if she hasn't seen them today?
Tony's never been much good at telling lies.
No, I sent him round at lunchtime with her present. He was going to say we'd be out this afternoon. Well, I hope the food's safe with them. I gave Kate a huge lunch.
You do know Peg's supposed to be having a drink with Jack Woolley this evening?
Yes, that's all right. It's going to be a two-tier party. Tea with the kids this afternoon, and dinner with the adults this evening. She can have a drink in between.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday.
Hot news.
Joe Grundy, what are you doing here?
Sorry. Spoiling the party, am I?
Oh, Joe, do tell us what you want quickly. We're expecting Mum at any minute.
I can guess. I think you'll have to come soon, Jennifer.
You're like a bad penny, you are.
I don't want to intrude on a family occasion, of course. No, I was just wondering, Missus. When I mentioned that I was after a flour mill, you didn't seem sure whether you had one or not.
Yes, I have, and I'll give it to you, but not now. Come tomorrow and I'll find it.
What a crowd.
Are you ready, Mum? Oh, hello, Joe. Pat.
Hello. I hear it's your birthday, Mrs. Archer. Many happy returns today.
Oh, thank you, Joe. That is kind.
Kind, stirring up trouble as usual.
Oh, Mum, Pat and I were going to sing for you. And we've got a surprise. A party. All the children are in the back.
Party for me. Oh, Jennifer, I thought you weren't going to bother.
I'm just providing the venue. It was Pat's idea. And she's done all the organising.
I hope you don't think it's silly, Peggy.
It's been a surprise at our party. I can tell you that for nothing.
Be quiet, Joe. No one wants to know.
You thought of it, Pat. Oh, and I was afraid that... Well, how nice.
My birthday present, Peggy. Well, the main part of it anyway.
Well, thank you, Pat. It's really the nicest present I could have. The children are waiting if you'd like to go through.
Yes, come on, Peg. You see, I told you you were being silly.
Well, that's all settled then. Do you think you might find this flour mill for me now? Seems to think I've come all this way for nothing.
Good evening, Nelson. My word, you're looking dapper tonight.
Dapper? You make me sound like Colonel Danby. Suave, sophisticated, elegant. That was the effect I had in mind.
Oh, well, that too, of course. I like the carnation. Who's the lucky lady?
Oh, you know, I'm going to see my bank manager. Oh, is that a bottle of my best champagne?
Yeah, and you charge enough for it. Should keep you in red carnations till next Christmas.
Never mind, I'm sure she's worth it, whoever your lucky lady is.
My mum, actually. It's her birthday.
Oh, that's very touching. Quite the devoted son.
Tell that to Pat. I hadn't got mum a present. We're giving her a party and we took something round from the kids, but that's not good enough, apparently.
Well, I'm sure my champagne will more than make up for it.
Cold to Newcastle. She's gone for a drink with Jack Woolley, but it was all I could think of. I'd better get back. She isn't supposed to realise it was a last-minute panic.
Yes, and I must collect Hebe. Doesn't do to keep a lady waiting.
Yeah. You're not going to Grey Gables, are you? Don't tell Mum you saw me.
No. Not the ambiance I'm looking for at all. A quiet, candlelit dinner for two in my flat. That's what I planned for the evening.
Did you speak to that bloke?
What bloke?
Well, there was a man in the wine bar waiting to see
it. He came out through the side. What sort of bloke, exactly?
He's got a briefcase with him. Said he'd tried earlier in the day, but he couldn't get in.
No, he could not. Did he say what... Has the boy no brains at all?
He said he'd been out half the night chasing barn owls.
Yeah. He called for a change of plan. I suppose you don't know if Grey Gables is very busy tonight.
Well, how would I know? Jack Woolley suggested we all come up for dinner.
You're not, are you?
Jennifer's giving us trout stuffed with celery and walnuts. Better than anything you get up there.
Oh, the food's not so bad if Jean-Paul's on form. Anyway, Hebe hasn't been there. It is one of the local sites.
Thought it didn't have the right ambiance.
Oh, perhaps not. But there's a chance I can get something there. I can't get it anywhere else in the country at the moment.
Oh, yeah? What's that?
Credit.
Are you ready to order now, Nelson? I don't know that.
Oh, I'm sorry. Are we keeping Jean-Paul from his bed?
You wouldn't do that. I just don't get any pudding, that's all.
Oh, my apologies to the chef. But Hebe is such a fascinating conversationalist.
It looks to me that you really like to be talking.
With thee conversing, I forget all time.
I know. That's why I popped over when she popped out.
Bright as a star when only one is shining in the sky.
If I could mention something as earthy and corporeal as food...
Ah, yes. Well, now we'll skip the start writing. Mm-hmm. What's good tonight?
All our food is delicious, naturally.
Oh, come on, Caroline. I'm in business myself. Don't push that tired old duck at me.
I wasn't going to. The place cookies and jack is what I'd have.
Then so shall we.
Both of you. Shall I wait till he begins?
No. She won't mind if I order for her. She's an old-fashioned girl. Besides, it looks like the only thing worth having on the menu.
Do you want to bother with our tedious old wine list?
No, I don't think so. As it's fish, we may as well stick to champagne. Another bottle, please.
I see. Well, if you're sure.
It's all Hebe can drink. She's got a delicate metabolism.
That's a good line. I must remember it.
You know how careful singers have to be about their throats.
We wouldn't stop blowing cigarette smoke all over them. Are we putting all these on the bill?
Ah. Yes, the bill. I wanted a little word while Hebe was away to save any possible embarrassment.
You mean you can't pay it?
Well, of course I can pay it. Eventually, but not tonight. So, do you think you could put it on my slate?
Your slate? What slate?
I'm an old and valued customer. Surely you can make an exception just this once.
It's always had a
fit. Well, you never know. You can juggle the books a bit, can't you?
I really don't see why I should.
It's only for a few days. I'll be able to pay by the end of the week.
I bet that's what you say to all your creditors. Oh, my dear.
Caroline, you're a treasure.
I'm an idiot. I can hardly turn you away hungry at this time of night.
Your price is above rubies.
Just this once. And I'll tell you one thing. No more champagne. You can have the housewife and Hebe will just have to cough.
I'm thinking of doing an article on this barn owl survey. Elizabeth's got all the details.
Sort of nature notes, you mean?
Mm.
I don't know if that's going to improve our circulation figures.
Well, it's a very important project, Jack. And unless you're going to start issuing bingo cards...
I don't think I haven't thought of it. The Echo's losing money all the time. And Grey Gables isn't looking too healthy.
You could have Nigel Pargeter as our foreign correspondent. That should liven things up.
That boy. Much as he can do to sign a cheque, isn't it? And then they bounce.
He seems to manage Nelson's bar quite successfully.
Yes, well, compared with Nelson, he's Charlie Claw. I wonder where Caroline's got to.
I bet there's some crisis at Grange Farm. There usually is.
He says there haven't been any written objections to the churchyard levelling.
There you are, Jack. Hold the front page. Banner headline, Sexy Vicar in Graveyard Rumper.
I wish you'd take this seriously, Janitor. You might be able to help.
Actually, I'm surprised Joe Grundy hasn't objected. He picked up enough fuss at the time.
Oh, ask Clarrie about it. She's come with Caroline now.
Oh, good. I've got a bone to pick with this bone.
Oh, here we are at last. We couldn't find William's blanket.
He won't let me leave him unless he can have his blanket.
But at least you can wash it. Adam had a smelly little pillow.
Oh.
Remember Cotelia's little horse?
Good morning, Caroline. I'm glad you've come.
I said I would. I'm glad you managed it, though. I bet you've got a busy morning.
I have heard. Going through the restaurant receipts, including last night.
Oh. Not now, please, Mr. Willie.
All right, but I'll speak to you later.
How was our birthday party, Clarrie?
He didn't come.
Oh, dear, what a shame.
Oh, and I'm sorry about Joe spoiling your surprise.
No, he didn't really. He just surprised me and Pat.
What a surprise is that man? But then who isn't?
Still, at least you've got your flour mill now, Clarrie, haven't you?
Oh, this organic stuff is like some sort of mania.
Yes, very kind of you to give it us.
Oh, that's all right. I never use it.
There is just one thing.
Yes?
How do you use it? Exactly.
I know where I'd be if I was a barn owl or a night like this.
I'm sure she hasn't flown out yet.
I'd be in a barn, too wet to woo.
She's not wooing, she's hunting.
I wasn't talking about her. Oh, hey, couldn't you stand a bit closer to me? I'm cold.
Oh, do stop moaning, Nigel. I wish I'd never asked you.
I don't know why you did.
I thought you were interested in barn owls.
I thought you were interested in me.
Hand me the binoculars, please. There's something in that tree over there.
I'm interested in you. Oh, Lizzie, I haven't got long. They're sending me to Africa and I might not come back.
The binoculars, Nigel. Quick.
You could at least send me away with a few happy memories. Oh, Lizzie.
Get off, Nigel. You're dripping all over me. Just give me the binoculars.
Here you are.
Thank you. No, that's not her.
I thought we could walk hand in hand under the stars.
What's that? I wish it wasn't so cloudy.
And here I am with rain dripping down my neck with my feet in a puddle. Well, can't we go for a drink?
We haven't seen the owl yet.
But though not even that sou'wester can dim the bright beauty of your hair.
Nigel, will you shut up? Least self-respecting owl is going to come anywhere near us if he's dribbling on like that.
I'm sorry. Most girls like to be told they're beautiful.
Why bring it up now? Just go and merge into the background.
Thanks a bunch. Is there anything else I can do?
You could build me a nest box for this owl.
Wait.
It's not that difficult. You can modify an old teacher.
Fair lady, it is your own true knight that calls you. What shall I do for your honour? Shall I kill dragons, fight champions, slay giants? No, you can modify an old teacher, really.
Well, you are. Guinevere probably liked dragons.
I expect she was counting them for a dragon survey. If I did make this nest box for you, what would I get in return?
The barn owls would be very grateful.
And what about you? Oh, do put those binoculars away.
What will it take to shut you up, Nigel? If I kiss you, will you turn into a frog and just croak?
I'm practically underwater as it is. Oh, Lizzie.
Oi! You! Who's there?
I don't believe it.
Shh, Dad, you're frightening the owls.
Oh, it's you, Elizabeth. Well, if you told me you're going owl hunting... Oh, hello, Nigel.
Evening, Mr. Archer. I'm just helping Elizabeth with her owl survey.
Yeah. I see. Takes two of you, does it?
Nigel's going to build me a nest.
He's going to do what?
For the owls, Mr. Archer. So we're just, well, we're just under-prospecting.
You don't mind, do you? I know you want to encourage them.
Oh, yes. This is the night I'd have chosen for, prospecting.
Yes. Well, we were just going. Hebe's on at Nelson's tonight. We don't want to miss her. Come on, Elizabeth.
Now, I'm safe to leave you in charge, am I, Caroline? No more meals on credit.
I have apologised. It was the first time.
Word gets round, Caroline. Nelson will be telling all his flash friends, go to Grey Gables, you can get meals on tick there.
We could do with a few new customers.
Not that sort of customer. That's why I wanted to put a stop to it before it goes any further.
I won't do it again, I promise. What even if Princess Margaret turns up?
I've been trying to get Nelson all day, but I can't get through. I don't suppose he's paid his phone bill either.
In fact, he's just not answering it. That might be a wise move.
But he's bound to be in the bar tonight. Because of that singer of his?
Yes. I don't think he'd miss her even if the police were after him.
So, I'm going down now to get me money.
You won't make a scene, will you?
Not unless I have to.
Shall I go? It was my fault, really.
He'd get round you again. You're too soft-hearted. And Nelson can charm the birds off the trees.
I wish you'd let me cover it till he pays.
Don't be silly. Not your debt.
We may genuinely not have the money.
It's not the money, Caroline. It's the principle of the thing. I can afford to have Nelson book me if the worst comes to the worst. Other people can't.
Yes.
It's not fair on all the little people to let Nelson get away with it.
What do you think Benny owes money to? More the electric and gas boards.
Nationalised industries, Caroline. We're all taxpayers. Nelson's taking money from people who can't look after themselves.
He's not actually mugging people in the street, you know.
He picked the wrong man in me, because I can look after myself, as he's about to find out.
Yes, Mr.
Oh, what a girl. What a song.
I can see it would appeal to you.
Come on now, Lizzie. But you were singing along, hey? But I saw a tear in your eye.
Trick of the light. Where we all have our fantasies.
Yeah. Another drink.
Clear up, Nigel.
Nelson?
Another drink, Nigel.
Yes, please. A brandy Alexander and a dry white.
Oh, I don't know how you can drink that stuff.
I need warming up. It's the nearest thing you can get to coke.
Well, I don't know why anyone needs to drink at all. The sound of Hebe's voice is enough to intoxicate me.
Just as well for you, everyone doesn't feel the same way.
The night and the song and the beauty.
If you've been in the bit of night I've been standing in for the last 2 hours, you'll need a drink too.
Certainly bring them in.
Yes, I think Hebe's going to pull it off for me. If my incompetent temporary barman can refrain from supplying my creditors with my name, address and telephone number.
That's not very fair. I stopped the man who wanted to take the piano away. It was only the chap with the briefcase. And he hasn't been back.
There you are, my dear.
Thank you, Nelson. Cheers.
That reminds me, you owe me a tenner. I had to slip the broker's man a fiver each to get rid of it.
Oh, have these drinks on the house.
I must say that this wine will be the most expensive I've ever drunk.
I say, no, that's a bit steep.
I'll add it to your wages, then.
Yes, and that's another thing. I've got a lot of stuff to get for Africa.
Oh, you promised me you'll take Colonel Danby's pit helmet. It did suit you.
Yes, yes, you'll get paid. I'd work here for nothing, just for the chance to hear Hebe sing.
Yes, and you haven't paid her yet.
She thinks it's worth singing for nothing, just for the chance to work here.
Hebe is an artist. She doesn't concern herself with such mundane matters.
Oh, yes, she does. She's been sounding me out about it. In the nicest possible way, of course.
Nelson, Gabriel, I want a word with you.
Gosh, everybody's here tonight.
Ah, Jack, come to see Hyde's son, eh? I'm afraid I didn't notice you in the crush.
Evening, Mr. Willie. Oh, it's still raining, is it?
Pouring. I've been trying to get hold of you all day. There seems to be something wrong with your phone.
Oh, is there? I've really been too busy to notice.
Not answering the phone's not going to help. I want my money.
Join the queue.
Jack, please lower your voice. I'm sure we can sort this out in a civilised manner.
Very easily. You just give me £45 from your till. Soft-talking Caroline into letting you run up a bill that size.
You should see some of the others.
Hey, you're a businessman. You must know I can't do that. It would throw my accounts into utter chaos.
Try my checkers in the post.
Ah, as Elizabeth so intelligently points out, I can just write you a check.
And it'll bounce all the way from here to Threadneedle Street. I want my money. Now. And I'm not going till I get it.
Oh, good. Hebe's going to sing again.
Have the grace to let us finish our act in peace, Jack. Then I'm sure we can come to some suitable arrangement.
And it worked. He didn't make a fuss. No, just stood there transfixed. All that music soothing the savage breath. She really is something. She's a siren, quite literally. Cast a spell on men and they're helpless. Nelson's quite gaga over her. Well, surely the spell only lasts while she's singing. What happened when she stopped? Didn't Mr. Woolley want his money then? Well, he might have done. And by then, Nelson had disappeared. Disappeared? Where to? Lord knows. I think he can make himself invisible. You see how else he keeps escaping all his creditors. Well, he can't stay invisible for the rest of his life. No, Jack Woolley said he'd be back. Nelson will just have to arrange for Hebe to start singing the minute he walks through the door. Hasn't paid her yet, either. Or Nigel. I shall have a word or two to say to Nelson about that. You're very protective towards Nigel. Well, you know what he's like. Shouldn't be let out without a keeper. And that's what you are, is it? Somebody's got to take him on now you've dropped him. Mind it being me? Not at all. Oh dear, what a pity.
Have you seen David? I can't find him anywhere.
Oh, the tractor's got a blocked injector. But he should be in the shed. Graham popped in. Well, he said he's been having trouble with that carving, if you've got a minute.
Oh, Lord.
I was going to try and get the ewes sorted out by this morning. We should have done it at the beginning of the week.
Oh, I don't suppose David will be long. You won't forget about the tree planting, after all that stuff you grubbed up on the Willows farmland last year.
No, Elizabeth, I won't forget, but not today. We're up to our eyes in it now the cows are in.
Those trees won't be ready for your barn owls to nest in for decades yet. We conservationists take a long view.
I'm not going to trip over Nigel Pargeter today, am I? Counting sheep or something?
I shouldn't think so. You're giving Nelson a hand.
Go on, Elizabeth, if you want to lift to the text.
Oh, well, that's a relief.
Counting the takings. Just hope there's something to count.
Hi, Nigel. How's things? I hear last night was quite a success.
It'll need to be. The man with the briefcase has caught out with Nelson at last.
Oh, dear. Is that bad?
He's from a firm of solicitors. That's all I know. Doesn't sound very promising to me.
No, it doesn't. And Nelson didn't manage his disappearing act this time.
Hardly. The man was waiting on the doorstep when we came to open up.
Oh, dear. Where is he now?
Nelson took him to the flat. They've been gone an awfully long time.
Well, you never know. Perhaps someone's left him a legacy.
I just hope it's a big one.
Oh, bless you.
Oh.
Are you all right? You look a bit under the weather again.
Oh, it's cold. I got very wet last night.
You will go on these nature rambles with my little sister.
I thought it might be a way to her heart. I've come to the conclusion she hasn't got one.
She's very fond of animals.
Yes. Well, I shall have webbed feet and a beak if I spend much more time with her. Not that I've got much time left.
Oh, come on, Nigel. It's only a cold.
I meant before I go to Africa.
Hello, Sheila.
Oh, Nigel. Hi. You don't have to go if you don't want to, Nigel. You're a free agent.
Easy for you to say that. Morning, Caroline.
Mr. Woolley hasn't been in yet, has he?
Where's Nelson?
Being a man with a briefcase.
I suppose he wants his money, too.
Yes, but there's more to it than that.
He'd be spell worn off.
I thought it would.
No, it hasn't. That's the whole point. And I wanted to warn Nelson. I rather feel I got him into this.
Ah, a welcoming party. How nice.
Oh, good, Nelson. There's something I must tell you.
Heavens, you sound cheerful.
Someone has left you a legacy.
Not exactly, but you're warm. And to think I've been avoiding that man all the week.
You mean he wasn't a creditor after all?
What, did he want
to? No, that's the irony of it. He was representing Bill Regan, an old business associate of mine. And he's gone bankrupt.
Oh, Nelson, you are here.
Look, Nelson, just let me warn you.
I don't know, Nelson, you do pick them.
That good news?
Because he owes me money. I was one of his creditors. I've written the debt off a long time ago. But now it's all official. He'll have to pay me. Well, some of it at least. Jack, come and bask in my good fortune.
You're going to pay my bill then, are you?
Yes, why not?
There you are, Mr. Woolley. I told you.
Well, can I have my wages while you're at it?
He owed you a lot, did he, this friend of yours?
Well, not that much. But naturally, Jack, since I regard yours as a debt of honour...
Oh, that's all right, Nelson. No rush. That wasn't why I came down.
Oh,
I wanted to see Hebe. Perhaps you could tell me where she's staying.
Why, she's a
tyrant. Hebe, why do you want to see Hebe?
Not just to ask for her autograph, I'm afraid.
Well, I must admit, I was impressed by her. Very impressed indeed.
Alice, you can't see it from there. Come and look proper.
You've still got half a sack to do. Joe wants to take it round the shops tomorrow.
Oh, don't have to do it all. Let me take a sample, see what they think.
Yeah, I suppose you're right.
Come and look at my stenciling. Neat, eh?
Bit wobbly. Milk's running.
Not bad for a first try. You don't want it to look too good.
Oh, well, you'll be all right then.
It's supposed to look like something we've knocked up in this back kitchen.
Yeah, well, the flour certainly does. Do you really think anyone's going to buy it?
I sound like hotcakes.
I wouldn't use it to make hotcakes. Wouldn't use it for anything.
It ain't people like you who are going in them health food shops. It's Jennifer Aldridge and her kind.
I hope we can get rid of it. And flour all over the place. I've had a bath, William, 3 times today.
You've only been a snowman.
Not a very bright one.
Maybe we should take a bag round to Jennifer Aldridge. Sort of test it out.
Be polite, I suppose. You know, she gives us the mill. Don't seem much of a thank you, though. It's such a funny colour.
That's all right. It looks healthy.
Not to me, it doesn't. Nice, clean, white flour. That's what I like. This has got bits in it.
It's supposed to have bits in it. Dad thinks he'd had a few more.
Well, he can do it, then, instead of sneaking down the pub.
He can't do the stenciling because the rheumatism in his hands.
And he can't do the grinding because of his farmer's lung, I know.
How many bags do you reckon we'll need?
2?
Oh, don't be daft.
You said he'd only need a sample.
Yeah, but if they like it, they might want some for Saturday. Well, that's when I'll sell it most.
I wouldn't bank on it. And I'm not using it up, I've told you.
You should be a bit more enthusiastic.
It might be if my arm wasn't dropping off.
Have a break, then. You just start filling the bags for me.
That's your idea of a break, is it? Oh, Lord.
Want me to go? You could do the fence limp. Only mind the ink.
No, what that baby wants, you can't get him.
Joe, you've heard of the cat and fiddle, have you?
No, but I like to change now and again.
No, Lord, again.
But you can sit with me if you like. I want to work.
I am honest. Eddie ain't coming out this evening, so I thought I might as well enjoy the peace and quiet.
He's not ill, is he?
No, working for a change. Getting the little bags ready for our own ground flower.
Oh, you're really going in for it, then?
Playing with William Stenfield, just like a kid himself.
Well, he must be keen to pass up his evening point.
Well, I guess he'll have a drink. Anyway, it's got to be done. I'm taking it round the shop tomorrow.
You reckon you'll sell it?
Well, I don't see why not. I was an organic farmer when Tony Arthur was still in Nablus.
Well, that's one way of looking at it. But I'm glad you come in. Richard's been trying to get hold of you.
Well, I ain't hard to find working away at the farm unless I'm down to Capville, of course.
Yes, well, he don't go in there much. But he ain't had a written objection from me yet about the churchyard levelling.
Ah, well, I ain't going to waste me time writing nothing down. He knows what I think,
but that's the system. If he don't get any written objections by the end of this week, you go ahead.
We'll do that anyway, so what's the point?
Well, we can leave Susan's grave, even if we level all the rest.
And then everybody'll say, look at that awkward cut, Joe Grundy. He always has to be different. My Susan wouldn't want that.
Well, if you're sure.
Outnumbered as usual. Still alive.
Oh, you flip.
And if no one's going to back me up,
we can go ahead then, eh?
Oh. You're waiting for my permission, are you? Now there's a novelty.
It's the system. He wants to do it properly.
It don't make no difference in the long run. Dust to dust and ashes to ashes.
You've got such a cheerful way of looking at things.
Good evening, Mr. Forrest. Oh, it's chilly tonight, isn't it?
Hello. You still here? I thought they were shipping you off to Africa.
Be warm enough for you there, I reckon, eh?
Not until after Christmas. Yes, I suppose so. I've never been that good in it, actually. You haven't seen Lizzie at all, have you?
Lizzie?
Yeah.
Elizabeth.
No, she ain't come in while I've been here.
Working your way through the family, are you? I just got to see you.
She didn't seem that keen about speaking to me. Seems to run in the family.
She said she'd meet you then, did she?
Mm. She ain't the most reliable girl in the world, from what I've heard.
Oh, I expect I've got it wrong. I do get a bit muddled sometimes.
Why don't you just pop round to Brookfield?
I wouldn't. You got your pride, ain't you?
I suppose I could. Oh, I just hang on here a bit first.
Not helping now, tonight, tonight then.
Oh, you're Mr. Woolley's after that, Hebe.
Oh, he never is. And him old enough to be a grandfather.
To stay at Grey Gables, Mr. Grundy. Yes, I'm afraid so.
Well, do you think she'll go?
I don't know why folks want singing going on while they're eating. It'll put me off my food.
Evening, Uncle Tom.
Yo. Ah, you're still new. Then you can ask him about Elizabeth.
Yeah, but he's got to warn you all.
Hello, evening, Mr. Archer. Cold again.
Yes, I've got a message for you from Elizabeth.
There you are.
She's sorry, she won't be able to see you tonight. She's got a panic on about an essay for college. I'm driving her over to Jennifer's now for some books.
Oh, I see. Well, naturally, her work must come first.
Good thing she's taking it serious. But she says it's still all right for tomorrow, whatever that means.
Sounds interesting.
Oh, I see. Is she in the car? Well, perhaps I could have a word.
Well, I'd rather you didn't. That's why I came in, not here. We are in a hurry.
Oh, Elizabeth always was a bit of a character.
It's all right for tomorrow. Sounds clear enough to me.
So, I better get on. Good night, everybody.
So long, then, sir.
Good night. Oh, Lord. He doesn't like me very much, does he?
You don't want to take no notice of Phil. His bark's worse than his bite.
You seem to be doing all right with these daughters.
I'm sorry to disappoint you, Mr. Grundy, but what Lizzie wants me to do tomorrow isn't really going to be much fun.
Very kind of you to help her out, Jennifer.
Not at all. It's probably best if she just browses among my books and sees if there's anything she needs, and then we can have a chat.
Oh, this last-minute panic. She's lucky to have you to call on.
Well, I'm quite flattered. I'm beginning to feel that Home Farm is Ambridge's answer to the British Museum. Look at Tony browsing away there.
Hmm? What about Brian's magazines? Give him some of the credit.
Oh, I was the one who suggested they might have some stuff about organic farms.
Yeah, yeah. Sorry. I'm very grateful. You can have our first bunch of carrots.
I wouldn't mind having a look through them myself sometimes.
Oh, don't say you're another convert to the cause.
Well, any sensible farmer's got some doubts about this energy-intensive agriculture we all go in for. Especially if he's in dairy.
How's Graham these days? Any less suicidal?
He's doing his AU course, isn't he?
Yes, that seems to have helped get things in perspective, but David and I are still having the devil's own job stopping pushing cake into the herd.
Oh, no professional cowman's going to like starving them. Here, don't tell Pat about this course. She'll have me on it.
You suit herself now she's your cowman. I saw that Day in the Life of a Vet, or whatever it was, when I was desperately looking for some cartoons for Kate. It's very interesting.
Yeah, a bit chatty, I saw. Still, I suppose you've got to get people hooked.
Oh, yeah. You can get very educated when you're looking for something to keep the kids quiet early in the morning.
They're on at lunchtime at the weekend for another class of milking. Starting again in January, if Pat's interested.
When she's not too busy grinding her own flour like poor Clarrie.
We're going to grow our wheat specially first, not just use any old rubbish that's lying around.
I was thinking of doing some tree planting on Willow Farmland, Tony. Would you like to come and take a look at it with me? You know better than I do.
Good for you, Phil. I've got Brian to tag some hedgerow saplings, so the hedge cutter will give him a miss.
Well, I haven't got much on tomorrow. Unless there are any emergencies.
Fine. Well, I'll go and hurry Elizabeth up. Otherwise, it'll be up all night with this essay of hers, and none of us will be fit for anything in the morning.
And he actually had the nerve to bring a bag of the stuff round. The cheek of it.
Any good, was it?
Oh, I wouldn't use it for wallpaper paste. Pat didn't think it was so bad. Blimey, you have taken a lot out here.
Yeah, I'm afraid I did go a bit wild, but all those old hedges were so higgledy-piggledy. It's much tidier like this.
Yeah. Bit bleak. Easier to plough, of course.
Well, I'd like to repair some of the damage, only I quite forget where everything went. The hedge followed the line of the hill, didn't it?
Yeah. And you left this old oak at least, so you could use that as a starting place.
Well, I'm not a vandal, Tony. This is a magnificent old tree.
Oh, I doubt you could have shifted it anyway.
Hang on. There's someone up here.
Is there?
Yeah. Look, the branch is swaying, and I can see a foot.
Well, those horribies, I bet.
Well, it's Nigel.
Nigel?
Yeah, he must be practicing for Africa.
Nigel?
What on earth do you think you're doing?
There is a perfectly reasonable explanation. Hello, Tony.
Hello. Well, you might get away from the lions, Nigel, but the elephants will just shake the tree.
And then he said, well, I'm building a nest.
Oh, my word. You never did.
Well, I was. I was putting out one of Lizzie's nest boxes for a blasted barn owl.
Oh, you should have seen Phil's face.
I haven't laughed so much in years.
Well, it does sound comical.
It was starting to be very funny. In fact, if I wasn't going to Africa, I think he'd have me deported.
Well, and Elizabeth told him what you were doing.
She meant to, but she got into a panic about his essay. She was supposed to be helping me.
Yeah, well, I wondered where Jane was.
When she didn't turn up, I thought I might as well get on with it.
Well, she'll be pleased anyway. There's one nesting box for a barn owl.
No, there isn't. It fell off.
Missed all by inches.
Oh, I haven't had such a good afternoon for years.
Ah, well, it's a thought that counts.
Next time I climb a tree, I think I'll just stay there.
Oh, cheer up, Nigel.
Come on, I'll get you another drink. How about you, Uncle John?
No, thanks. No, I'm all right. Well, it certainly perked you up.
First there was Eddie Grundy and his own ground flour. That was a good laugh.
Jennifer said it looked pretty rough.
Yeah, and then there was Tarzan here.
Don't mind me. I'm used to being a figure of fun. I could go on the halls if they hadn't all closed down.
I might have guessed. Somebody making a racket, you might know it's an arse.
He's in here.
I said he would be.
Of course, but you came straight away.
Hey, where is this? A family outing?
Would you like my chair, Mrs. Grundy? Oh.
Did you want me specially? Or is this just a social call?
Yes, we do. But you'll never guess why.
Thank you, Mr. Carpenter. Isn't it nice we can all get out together with something to celebrate for once?
Your elf hasn't turned up at all, has he?
Yes, it must be nice to have something to celebrate.
Oh, go on. Out with it.
We thought you'd like to know, and we'd buy you a drink to show you there was no hard feelings.
Seeing as though we were tipped you to the post life.
Hey, you're in the competition.
I could see from your face this morning you didn't think we'd do it.
Do what, for heaven's sake?
Well, go on, you tell him, Clarrie.
So sold our flour to Bortis and Elson shop. Isn't that amazing?
Well, that is a surprise.
Oh, congratulations, Clarrie. Oh, you must be very pleased. I've heard how hard you worked.
You mean they liked it?
They loved it. Over the moon they were.
I'll take as much as we can supply.
Well, that is nice for you, Clarrie, love. After all you've done.
I know, isn't it wonderful? One of our schemes really works. So we have got something proper to celebrate for once. Thank you.
Archers was written by Mary Cutler and produced by William Smethurst. The agricultural story editor was Anthony Parkin, and the director in our Birmingham studios was Peter Windows. Well, Tom Forrest has been played by Bob Arnold since the series started in 1951, and on Tuesday afternoon, Bob Arnold reminisces about his life before and away from Ambridge, and even sings some of the songs he learnt from the regulars in his father's Cotswold pub. I bet one of them's the village pump. But you can find out if I'm right on Tuesday afternoon at 4 when Tom Forrest says, "Morning all."